So, it's my pleasure to open the presentation. Professor Sergeldin's. Professor Sergeldin is distinguished professor and honorary doctor of our university. Last year, he was elected as honorary doctor, and His Excellency is a famous scholar, and in nowadays the director of the Library of Alexandria, the director of the World Digital Library, as well as former vice president of World Bank. So it's great pleasure and honor for us to have today well-known scholar and scientist, as well as distinguished person. And let me open the presentation. Ma'ali Doctor, shukran lihazihi ziyara. Rahib wa nuhayikum fil jami'at al-hurra. Hadha sharaf kbir. لجامعتنا نتمنى أيام مثمرة في جورجيا وفي القوقاز وآملين سوف نلتقي مرة أخرى في جورجيا ونتمنى لكم توفيق وتطور وتقدم شكرا جزيلا
Yes, I can. I think the microphone is working all right and everybody can hear me. And I want to thank His Excellency the Director. And before I start, I want to apologize to our colleagues who have been here and have been waiting. It is a bit unfortunate, but traffic was rather difficult. And I think in addition to traffic, we took a couple of wrong turns to get here. So let me start with you. Today my topic is reflections on the Alliance of Civilizations. One of my various responsibilities is also I'm an ambassador, a goodwill ambassador for the Alliance of Civilizations. And in even thinking about what's going on in the last few days, it's been a further reminder of the need of reinventing the relations between the West and the Muslims. So with that, I will show you many, many pictures. So please tie your seatbelt and let's get started on going ahead. And we'll start with the idea of civilizations and cultures. And what I'm talking about here, what is a culture? It is not just the arts and the letters produced by a society. It is the entire complex of spiritual, material, intellectual, emotional features that characterize a society or a social group. And it also includes modes of life, fundamental rights of human beings, value systems, traditions, and beliefs. All of that is part of that. And of course, when we come to Islam and the Muslim societies and the West, the nation, the issue of value systems, traditions, and beliefs becomes important. And our civilization, on the other hand, is the product of the laws and institutions that within these sovereign units create to organize the transactions of daily life. It comes, after all, from Civicus, and Dr. Farida Al-Laqi is one of the founders of Civicus and civility and civilization. So the civil organization of things, the rights of citizenship, and so on. And the predominant culture shall be closely reflected usually in the constructed civilization, whatever that predominant culture is. But there are always minority cultures, and that's why democracy, with this emphasis on pluralism, that allows these things to coexist and these structures to coexist, in fact, create that. We can see in Europe, for example, a reversal of that somewhat by having multiple sovereign units that can create a single civilized groups such as Europe with cultures within it, like the French culture, the German culture, and so on. But even there, inside the French culture, you have the Corsican and the Hollande and the Breton and so on. And now with this, are we creating a new global civilization? That is really what we want to do. But the global civilization will be dependent on the relationships between various cultures. Although in a very famous book, Samuel Huntington referred to it as a clash of civilizations, I will come to that in a moment. Now, globalization so far has really been on the issue of integrating markets. And it is leaving a certain situation where gaps between a subgroup, in particular sub-Saharan Africa, falling further behind compared to the rest of the world. But the world is connected in ways that it wasn't before, and information flows, and our perceptions of each other is affected by the images and the perceptions we get of other people. And that's one of my favorite pictures, how many channels you could watch simultaneously if you chose to do that. But for many of us, especially those who have not been in the dominant hegemonic cultures of the world, we're worried about how, for example, the view from Hollywood has, it's given a caricature of our societies, our culture, our history, our tradition. And it's that's very powerful in many parts of the world. And the uniqueness of indigenous cultures is being submerged in that general flow. But everywhere you go, even in the poorest areas of the world, and I love this picture from really a Sahelian village in sub-Saharan Africa, what is lovely is look how these women are decorating their houses. Now, there's no functional aspect to that decoration, but it is part of the expression of the local culture. It is an artistic expression. And even among the poorest people, there is that aspiration for the aesthetic, for that which goes above the everyday use. And that is what makes a culture. And when it gets translated into written laws and institutions, we have civilizations. So we want to go from the clash to a dialogue. With the collapse of the Soviet Union, for a while there was a terrible attitude, and there still is in some parts of the West. So triumphalism in the, some parts of the new conservative movement, that the world will become in America's hands. But then even Francis Fukuyama writes, the end of history, as if that conflict would be the end of history. We all know that, of course, it's not it. But Francis wrote later on another book called Trust, in which he talks about social capital as well. And then after that end of history argument came the argument of the clash of civilizations and the remaking of the world order. And it was a contribution of the late Samuel Huntington, professor at Harvard, who was very distinguished and did a lot of things. Even though I disagree with him on this particular book, I recognize his stature as an intellectual. The book has been looked at again because I think it's important that we remind ourselves of the subtitle. The clash of civilizations, that was known. People forget the second part and the remaking of the world order. So the idea is that after the Cold War, there is a new level of tension that will be translated into a new conflict, and the remaking of the world order should take that into account. And this is a summarization of the level of interaction between different cultures as he saw them in that book, and in which he emphasized this particular link between Western and Islamic civilizations as being where the clash was likely to occur, going to continue to occur, and so on. Now, a lot of people jumped on that, having lost the foreign enemy of communism. They said, well, the new is Islam and the Muslim world. To counter that, President Khatami of Iran then offered the world the suggestion of a dialogue of civilizations. And the UN responded with a dialogue of civilizations, and they wrote this very beautiful report, 20 very eminent people. dialogue among civilizations, and it was called Crossing the Divide. So rather than seeing it as a point of clash, they saw it as a divide, and that we need like to build bridges across that divide. And then after that came the idea of the Alliance of Civilizations, and it was really Prime Minister Erdogan and the Prime Minister of Spain, Turkey and Spain, who sponsored this idea. And they said, dialogue is not enough. Dialogue simply, we talk to each other, then everybody goes their own way. What we want to do is to figure ways in which these different civilizations go beyond dialogue towards an alliance to actually do good things in the world. And they named a distinguished group of people to organize that report, which was co-chaired by Federico Mayor and Mohammed Aydin. And I had the honor of being one of those members. And this was handing in our report with Kofi Annan there. And there's Prime Minister Erdogan, there's me, there's Prime Minister of Spain, and Mr. Khatami and others. And we presented, Ms. Desmond Tutu, there's many others in that group. And we presented our report at the time. And it focused really on lessons that we need to reach out, and this group is just perfect. We need to reach out to youth. We need to better use the media. I'm using media here. To address the issue of education, we are in a university, and above all, to find ways of collaborating, and that is the Alliance of Civilizations report of the High Level Group. The President of Portugal, former President of Portugal, Mr. Sampaio, has been named as the Under Secretary General in charge of the initiative for the Alliance of Civilizations. And he has named a number of the high-level group, including myself, as ambassadors. But I told a lot of people that, you know, this UN machinery is very out of touch, that a younger generation is dialoguing already among themselves across boundaries, across political boundaries, with new tools of the new century. And the speed with which it's happening, if you think of social networking, in 2002, it was Friendster, then MySpace. 2004, Facebook was born. 2005, YouTube. 2007, the iPhone, which allows people to do all the pictures that we know. And these things moved so quickly. And today, we all know Mark Zuckerberg and Facebook. But all these things have been moving with enormous speed. And virtual reality worlds have been created, new computer architectures being done, formalization of clusters, neural nets, virtual communities all over the world are happening. It makes you wonder where the world will be. And I tell my friends who are writing constitutions right now, think with some humility, who could have predicted Twitter and Facebook 10 years ago? Who would have predicted the internet 20 years ago? And then try to project forward 10 to 20 years and tell me where we will be. And you, the younger generation, are living that very closely, so it's up to you. But the digital future is already here. It's not something out there. It's already here. And it's expanding our brain's reach beyond anything that our parents could imagine. And it's changing with incredible speed. It's the dawn of a new age. So let's embrace it. And I'm proud that my institution is working very hard on these issues. And as the director introducing me, I'm proud that I've been elected the chair of the executive committee of the World Digital Library, among other things. So if we're complaining of Hollywood stereotyping, of political stereotyping, of ignorance of our cultures, which results in further stereotyping, what is it about reading a culture? Well, I will say a few words about the cultures of the Muslim peoples. I put it in plural because there's a lot of difference between what happens in Indonesia, what happens in Pakistan, in India, in Egypt, in Central Asia, in Turkey, in Morocco, and in the Muslim communities in the West. It's a world culture. The contributions of Muslim cultures to the world, to the history of civilization in the world, is enormous. Who denies that the Taj Mahal is a contribution to all of the world? The Alhambra is a contribution to all of the world, even though they are in predominantly non-Muslim societies. right now, one in India, one in Spain. From coins, to beautiful illustrations, books, to calligraphy, to architecture. But the problem is that superficial reading of the other culture can be very misleading. So I will give you three false dichotomies that come from quickly stereotyping about Muslim cultures. Let's talk about modernity and tradition. Modern are the Western cities and so on. Traditional are the old Eastern cities. This happens to be Bukhara in Uzbekistan. And the old part of the world has a tradition, and this is beautiful 10th century Kufic Arabic script. This is a modern piece of work that was done by Kamal Bulata, a Palestinian artist, inspired by Kufic script. And then here, I show you this. And it looks not only extremely modern, you may think it was inspired by a computer chip, or maybe by the works of Piet Mondrian, the great Dutch artist of the 20th century. But in fact, if you look at it again, you will see this is the word Ta'ali, flipped over four times. And this piece of work, modern as it may look, is actually a 16th century piece in the Topkapi Museum. Now, somebody produced that work totally unselfconsciously, not worrying about looking modern or looking traditional, but it just did something. And the notion of modernity and tradition is really lost on that. What about veiling? Well, it's not just women, it's also men sometimes. And sometimes you see women like this. This is a speakering in television in Egypt. And at the same time this, and it's not to do with education, because as you can see, she's a scientist. And I have this picture from girls working at a computer in the Library of Alexandria. Very different. Why do they do the veiling? Well, the veiling is not just guaranteed to be either for uneducated people or just of the East and so on. High tech and low tech, yes, well, large parts of the Muslim world are low tech. Compared, for example, to some of the Western museums. Modernity, after all, somebody feels it was invented in the West. This is the Guggenheim Museum for Modern Art. But so is this. This is an old building, already done 30 years ago in Malaysia. And this is a more recent building, the Petronas Towers in Malaysia, some of the most sophisticated skyscrapers, not to mention in Arabia, where you see these. But how about the worst of all the dichotomies, which is Muslim and non-Muslim? The general feeling is that somehow there's Muslims out there very different from non-Muslims. So I show you this gentleman. And this gentleman is not a sultan. He is actually Abraham ben Azra, who was the head of the Jewish community in Cairo in the 17th century. He was just dressed like any person at the time. More recently, this picture comes from the memoirs of Ahmad Shafiq Pasha in 1931, a sheikh and a priest. And you can't tell who's who. They are dressed exactly the same way. How about a Quran? Surely nothing could be more Islamic than a Quran. And I'll show you a Bible from the same Mamluk period. They use the same decorations. But arabesque. Arabesque designs were what the Muslims invented, and we know about how these Arabesque designs are found everywhere, including in palaces and in mosques. And this is the minbar of the Muayyad Mosque in Cairo. I show you the exact same one in the Gamaliya Church right next to it in Cairo. This is a church, and you can see here arabesques were used by both societies. Further, you will say, how about the veil? I will show you the veil. Yes, it exists in many Muslim societies today, but look at this one. Actually, this is a picture of the Orthodox Patriarchate Christian Copts in Egypt in 1923. All the ladies were there. This was a social custom. It was not a religious custom. In fact, the person who led the movement against veiling was a Muslim lady called Ash'arawi. And she led in 1924, 1 year after this picture, she led a revolution by going into the street and taking off the veil and demanding that women participate in the patriotic actions in Egypt. Of course, women did not have the vote then, but that's just goes to show that. How about this? This is the Coptic Museum in Cairo, commissioned and designed by Copts. And look, there's the cross in the middle there. But where did they go for inspiration? The Al-Aqmar Mosque from a Fatimid period in old Cairo next to it. So what I want to say about that is that life is more complex and culture is much more complex than to simply say, this is Muslim, this is non-Muslim. No, there is an interaction between all the component parts that creates society. And what we'd like to think of when we talk about Cairo and our tradition and our heritage is that, in fact, it is an evolving situation where Muslims and non-Muslims contributed, where they lived side by side, where they felt that they were part of Egyptian society and could contribute. And these are some of those examples. So how do cultures evolve? Well, since we are in university, I will give you an analytical model of how cultures evolve for the Muslim world. There's an intellectual domain, a perceptual domain, and a physical domain. Intellectual domain is where the philosophers and theologians and so on function, and they produce what we call theoretical ethics. But most people in society don't understand these things, and they have what we can call practical ethics, which is what they think is Allah. And in spite of all the great ulama talking about how there is la ikraha fi al-deen, and some people below feel differently. Why? Because it's a degraded form of that. But then there's also what people actually do, not just what they believe is right, but what they actually do. And that's social praxis. So if you go and photograph a film, or if you're an anthropologist and you go and study a society, that is what you see in everyday practice. And it is governed by that. How do they relate together? Well, as I mentioned, theoretical ethics is degraded into practical ethics. That's what people think. For example, how could good Christians think for a while that they could organize the Inquisition? How could good Muslims think for a while that you are entitled to not just coerce, but to kill someone else, although that is forbidden by every religious God? But it is practical ethics that governs the social values. Social values are what is expected of someone. And that's what governs individual behavior, because people want acceptance in their social groups. And when you collectivize individual behavior, that's what becomes social praxis. Now, in our societies in the East, especially in the more backward societies, there has suddenly been an enormous increase in impact on the social side. But I will come back to how the ideas evolve. So how did the theoretical ethics evolve? Well, for Muslims, the Quran is absolutely the first source. Then the Sunnah of the Prophet has been, of course, contemporary and taken with it in every way. And then there have been Greek and Latin influences that have found their way into the writings of the great ulama in the third century of the Hijrah, or the 10th to the 11th century AD, and local influences. Local influences are important. The great Imam Shafi'i, when he left Baghdad and came to Cairo, and they told him, you have changed your fatwa, your ruling. And he said, well, it's a different place. Baghdad is something and Cairo is another. And it was in his own lifetime. So if he was willing to accept these changes, imagine what happened. But modernizing influences are impacting on the social praxis. And sometimes this goes further up and then gets picked up and gets internalized. There's no problem with that. But if it persists long enough, it can go all the way up to theoretical ethics and then come down again. And you find that, for example, in issues of interest-bearing accounts for Muslims, big issues on that, on usury and other rates. In Catholic Christianity, there was a big issue about contraception and planned parenthood and so on. The Vatican made declarations on that. So things change in this way. But in addition, there's also physical change. This morning I showed an example of how certain societies that were nomadic suddenly found themselves settled down. I saw in the 70s, late 70s, entire villages in northern Yemen depopulated because of the enormous pool of the oil boom in Saudi Arabia. All the able-bodied men had gone to Saudi Arabia to work. The villages had only women, old men, and small children. The women took on many roles that would have traditionally been done by the men who are now working in Saudi Arabia. So these physical changes themselves, but internalized about what is acceptable or not acceptable for women to do. But education, modern education system, impact directly on the practical ethics. Not everybody is going to become a philosopher or a theologian. So it impacts directly, and the mass media. People are on the internet, on television, watching all sorts of things, movies, etc. And finally, new ideas. New ideas enter directly into the debates, as we talk about, for example, women's rights, human rights, ideas about organizational democracy, etc. So as long as that system is like that, that's fine. All the arrows on the left side are the arrows that bring the new, and these are the arrows that bring the roots. And in Arabic, I've written about that. I call it al-tajdid, the renewal, wal-taqsir. Now they have to go together in the two. But the problem is here, in those two red arrows that you see here. When there is a break, there is a wrenching, because these links are not functioning smoothly, then you start getting social pathologies. If the thinking, the dominant thinking is unable to cope with all the new and internalize the new, you get then pathologies, social pathologies and intellectual weaknesses. And when people talk to me in the Salafi tradition and say, you know, well, we want to go to the original way it was in old Islam, I say, very good, let's go. Let's go and see what did the Muslims do when they first confronted the writings of Plato and Aristotle. They didn't say that they were atheists. They didn't say that they should be burned. They didn't ban them. They translated them into Arabic. They wrote commentaries on them. They called them the two wise men, al-Hakimain. And they wrote exegeses. They took what was useful from it. They left what was not useful. And we have that long tradition and history that we know. So let me give you a visual example, because this sounds very abstract. There is a cultural code, and I will use architecture because I could use written texts, poetry, etc., but then there's difficulty in the languages to translate. This is a beautiful example of what a mosque or madrasa should look like. This particular one is one of my favorites. It's a Sultan Qayyim based madrasa, dates from 1350, 14th century in Cairo. And you say, what has that got to do with poor people like that? Or look at this, for example, from a fancy mosque of the period, and what has it to say to people who live like that? So I will show you that there was a code, and that what we now see as social pathology is because that code was broken. Let's take Cairo, an imperial city by any standard, an imperial capital, city of 1,000 minarets here, and a small village actually just west of the border in Libya, border of Libya and Egypt. Notice the verticality, this long verticality in the imperial example, and the verticality found in the small village. Notice the use of the double arch that you see here with the little niche next to it, and the use of the arch. Now, why would a small peasant in a village go through the trouble of trying to build something like that instead of just putting a small bar as a lintel, which would be so much easier? Nobody's forcing him or her to do it. like nobody was forcing these women, I showed you the picture, who were decorating their walls in the Sahelian. It's because he feels it is beautiful, it speaks to it, it's part of it. That's how internalized the aesthetics of that culture are. Look at that arch and that niche next to it, and let's go to the small household, and there's the arch and the niche. And these decorations actually are important. Look at the interplay of light and dark, and the interplay of light and dark in a given mosque. And these decorations speak to the people, to both the people who drew them and the people who see them. They talk of marriages, of travels, of pilgrimages, of celebrations. It's a living, functional code. There is a simplicity in this manifestation which is important. And so, wherever the code is not broken, you will find a certain harmony. It can be all modern or all ancient. It's the effort of combining the two that doesn't work. This is a well-done example from Mali, Mopti in Mali. The front is a very modern structure. The old mosque is behind it. But they work together well. But when the code breaks down, when these red arrows in the diagram, now I will show you how the whole code breaks down, and I will use an example which is well known. That's what most people in our part of the world think a mosque looks like. A dome, minarets, and a doorway to come in, and so on. Now, it's so well known that it's even used as a decoration for piety by folklore. Okay, you see this example that is used by local people to designate piety. And it's so well known, this is in Bangladesh, which is predominantly not just Muslim, but has many illiterate people. So the cutout here signifies mosque. There's the dome and the minaret. Mosque is nearby. I don't have to know. Now the minaret, this is from the Masjid Hussein in Cairo. The minaret has functions. It is a landmark. It is a way in which the call to prayer could be made from higher up. So much for the landmark function. Why would somebody build a minaret? I mean, it's one thing to build a minaret when it stands alone and everybody sees it, but it's another to build a minaret right next. Actually, this was built after the buildings. So in between the buildings, where it certainly can barely be seen. But why do people do that? Well, because you need a minaret. Why do you need a minaret? Well, because we need it. Now, on the other hand, in this case, this is a case of a mosque also in Cairo. The mosque itself is much smaller, but they put the minaret very, very, very tall, so that, in a sense, maybe it succeeds because the minaret is taller than the Coca-Cola sign, so it maintains spirituality higher here. On the other side, this is from Indonesia, and they've abolished the minaret. They put a functional minaret. Just two loudspeakers for the call to prayer on a rod. So, well, that's what the minaret is. So great, functionality. This guy, this is from Bangladesh, somewhere in between. Couldn't quite decide. Yes, well, there are the loudspeakers and the rod, but I also want the muezzin to go up and sit there and look down at people and so on. And this one is very cute. This is inside Cairo. There is a little teensy minaret here. And I asked the people who built this zawiya, and I said, why do you put that little thing there? And they said, because without it, it would not be a mosque. And I said, no, it's a mosque because you pray in it. It's not a mosque because you put the little thing about this size on top of it. And this is even worse. This is because the zawiya is on the first floor. And so the zawiya is here, and so they punched into the balcony of the guy next door to create their little minaret, because somehow it has to be there. You know, we can't let go of it. And this one, near my house in Cairo, in Giza actually, there's a little minaret and a little dome, but the loudspeaker is outside on the street light. Now this is a total collapse. The dome is also a very beautiful solution for a volume of space that creates unity and creates a sense of beauty inside it and so on. But look what happens. These are takeaway domes. actually designed in Indonesia, whereas they're willing to go functional on the minarets, they actually see here's the functional minaret, and they stick this little dome on top of it. And I asked them, why do you do this? And again, they said, because without it, it would not be a mosque. And I said, but you were willing to say it's a mosque, just we can announce the prayer by microphone. So there is this fear of letting go, because somehow we haven't symbolized the new. Now this guy, in his effort to symbolize the new, he called this the modern airplane mosque. This is in Dhaka, in Bangladesh. And in his image, the most modern thing that he could think of was an airplane. So he put an airplane on top of this tower, and he said the tower will function. It's in, near the garage, actually. There's a mosque at the bottom. So we need symbolism to be renewed in our culture at our time, and there is a possibility for purity and simplicity. This beautiful example was done by the great late Hassan Fathi. It's in the foreground. The balance, the simplicity, and here, yes, you have a straight staircase that takes the muezzin up here where he can actually give the call to prayer, but look at this dome now. This is a functional dome, a modern functional dome, that creates the space inside it and brings appropriate light for a small rural mosque. In fact, Hassan Fathi succeeds by using the strong sunshine outside to create the black and white lines that we used to find in rich stone. He did it with a mud structure with great talent. His disciple, Abdullah al-Wakil, used also a historic vocabulary to reinterpret it. But there are new interpretations. This is in Turkey, of what mosques could look like. This one is a prize-winning design in Bosnia, very modern structure, where the minaret actually has particular functions there, I can mention. And there was, unfortunately, sometimes this tension between the new and the old is found even in advanced societies like Turkey. Now, in this case, this is the Dorokai project for the Vedat Dorokai, for the new state mosque, Koçtepe Mosque in Turkey. But the government found it too bold at the time. And what they ended up doing was an exact replica of a mosque designed by Sinan in the 17th century. It's sad because when Sinan designed this, which is here, the original design of architect Sinan, he was very bold. Nobody designed mosques like that before Sinan, but after him, it became the traditional way mosques are everywhere, the dome and the minarets that you see. Dorokai built his vision in Pakistan. But anyway, so the question, therefore, is that societies change, cultures change, and new generations have to reinterpret their tradition in the language of the new and find new ways of living. Today, we talk of the knowledge-based society. But knowledge is more than information. If you have data and you organize the data, it becomes information. When you explain the information, it becomes knowledge. But we need more than knowledge. We need wisdom. The people who invaded Iraq had knowledge, but maybe not as much wisdom as they should have had. Now, science brings data, information, and knowledge. But wisdom comes back to values, traditions, discussions. And these values are so important that we understand them. There are universal values: honor, courage, compassion, common sense, all of these. Who can argue with all of these? Well, I would add to it love of nature today, and recognition that we did not inherit the earth from our parents, but that we borrowed it from our children and have a responsibility towards it, an appreciation of the arts, of music, and the tolerance of the other. Now, this is a cartoon about some Western societies today. It says, we are very tolerant, but if you don't behave exactly like us, you can go back where your bloody came from. Well, that's not quite tolerance either. There are values of science that pursue truth and honor and creativity and imagination and constructive subversiveness by which we change, which requires a tolerance of engagement and an arbitration of disputes by evidence. But in political terms, you arbitrate disputes by voting. So all of these values are there. To reflect these values in social action, I have a beautiful story of three children, a few flute I would like to tell you about, a parable. If you see three children with a flute and they say to you, help us decide who should get the flute. And this boy says, I'm very poor, I have no toys at all. The other two are very rich and they have many toys. Well, and they don't dispute, the others say, yes, that's true. And then you say, well, let's give it to the poor boy. Okay, let's imagine another scenario. Same three children, and they come to you, and the girl says, look, I am the only one who's really a musician. I love to play the flute, I play it beautifully. The other two boys, they don't know how to play the flute. They just push it like blowing on a whistle. They love to listen to me. I love to play. So give it to me, and then I can play, and they can listen. And they don't contest that. Again, in that case, you would say, well, she should get the flute. Third scenario, same three children, same flute. Now the third child tells you, I don't care if he's poor. I don't care if she's a musician. I made the flute. I took the wood and I made the holes in it and I built the flute. So what do you mean give it to them? Mine, I made it. And again, in that case, he's right. Now, those three cases really describe different kinds of things that we see and we have different criteria for social choice. In general, when you give it to the poor boy, that is referred to the criterion of equity. In the case of the preferring to give it to the real musician, that's referred to as utility. And in the literature, in macroeconomic theory, in the theory of social choice, and so you find these words used a lot. And the third one is known as the letter of entitlement. But all three are criteria for social choice. In the case of science, we arbitrate disputes by evidence. In the case of social interaction, we arbitrate it based on our values, on giving precedence today, in this situation today, to this value rather than that value, and we come back to reaffirming the other one because they are all right. There is none of them. There's no right answer and wrong answer. Each one of them is valid. So designing appropriate action requires agreement on these, and they reflect the values of the predominant society. But in no case can majority choices be allowed to infringe the human rights of the minority. And that's a fundamental principle. And that carries us into a debate about the Western and the Muslims. What is the Muslim world? Talk about the Muslim world. What is the Muslim world? Well, roughly this map has been reflected, but that map again mixes because there are different percentages in society who consider themselves Muslims in each of the societies. So this may be a better map, which shows percentages. Muslims as percentage of the national population, and there you can see percentages. But what's interesting here is look at what's happening in Europe. And compared to India, it's almost the same percentage. We think of Muslims in India as a big part of India, but we don't think of Muslims in Austria, France, and elsewhere as playing a big role. Look at Central Asia, all the enormous variety that exists in Central Asia that was for a long time subsumed under the Soviet Union, where neither the Orthodox Russian Church nor the Muslim minorities were recognized. Look at Afghanistan and the enormous variety that exists there. And look at Europe today and say to them, you in Europe have coped with your issues of minorities before. And I was recently speaking there and I said to them, you are no longer in a position where you can say that the Muslim world is out there. You are talking about Muslims inside your own societies. These are your children. They were born there. They were brought up there. They are citizens. They are a minority that you have to learn to deal with like any other minority. Now, in Europe, you have done a lot, but you still retain a very Eurocentric world. And that Eurocentric world has impacted us on history, geography, and the perceptions of modernity. Well, in fact, let me just say a word about that. In history, when so many of my European friends refer to the Dark Ages, I say, what do you mean the Dark Ages? These were the glorious years of Muslim civilization on the Eastern Mediterranean and all through to Spain. This was the, they are not dark at all. They were dark in Europe, but they weren't dark in the rest of the world. So the idea of referring to them as the Dark Ages is very Eurocentric. And then even our geography, we talk about the Middle East and the Far East. Middle and far related to who? For an Australian, the Far East is the near north. So even our language, our geography, and so on, it's all really impacted on by that. When we talk about the modern period, whose history are you looking at? And there are periods of modernity that transcend that, certainly the Muslim world. And then I like to use this example because I don't think many of you young people really fully realize that. I've worked a lot in Africa. And we say Africa. You know, we talk about Brazil and Argentina and Mexico and so on. And in Europe, we talk about Spain and Italy and so on. Then we say Africa. Well, Africa has over 1 billion people. It's going to have 1 billion and a half very soon. There's 53 countries. But I don't think anybody really fully realizes just how big Africa is. Just big. Look at this. You could fit China, United States, Alaska, and Europe, all of them inside Africa and still have Africa space left over. Africa is bigger than all of these places combined. And yet we say, oh, the US is a continent, China is a continent, and look, Africa. Africa, that is a very Eurocentric view that has been perpetuated after the Treaty of Berlin in 1885. And today there are new confrontations. And these new confrontations, whether dealing around the Palestinian issue or dealing with other issues, raise the questions of how are we going to cope with them. It is a very moving picture. To me, summarizes it. Is it going to be through books or bombs? Are we going to learn and talk to each other or bombs? So beyond the wars, there has been the emergence of terrorism. After 9/11, we have seen Madrid, but no less dramatic are other terrorist actions, most of which occurred in Muslim countries by some extremist terrorists, and I'm using the word extremist terrorist, against other Muslims, not against Westerners, mostly against other Muslims. And people, unfortunately, the media cover it as a very minor thing. And if you want to cover your eyes, if you are very sensitive, because I'm going to show you some rather harsh pictures. This is the picture of a car bomb as it would be normally carried in the media. But that's a clean picture. It really doesn't show what a car bomb looks like. And if you read in the newspaper, you read every day there were car bombs in Afghanistan and car bombs in Iraq. In Iraq, it's not against the Westerners. There are no Westerners. It's against the Shia and the Sunnis are blowing each other up all over the place. Because this doesn't show what happens to the human beings who are inside. Here's a picture of the real car bomb. It's terrible. The anger that comes, that is fed by seeing these kinds of things, I moved it quickly. But it's real, that's what it's all about. I mean, sanitizing it and putting it in behind it doesn't show the reality. People who have lost people in that fashion get very angry with each other, as well as with Westerners that they think are behind all of this. So the large part of the terrorism, we Muslims are victims of it as much as the Europeans are victims of it. In fact, much, much, much more. If you count the number of dead people on a daily basis in the last 15 years or 10 years, you will see the numbers of Muslims that have been killed otherwise. But Blaise Pascal, the great philosopher, said it right. Men never do evil so completely as when they do it from religious convictions. Many of the people who are terrorists, they are willing to blow themselves up. They believe that this pose is correct, even though the great ulama tell them, no, this is not correct, but they still do it. I will show you two other horrible pictures. One from what happened recently, beheadings, and one from the dark history of the Inquisition in Europe. the Spanish Inquisition, the Roman Inquisition. They tortured people. They did all sorts of terrible things. Why? Because they were doing it again out of conviction, religious convictions. Now, we don't want such horrors to be repeated, and we must beware of the first steps on a slippery slope to totalitarianism. To confront these problems, we have situations, and this is a great saying by Edmund Burke, the only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is for good men and women, to do nothing. And that's a very good statement. So today, Muslims kill many more Muslims than non-Muslims. And in addition to seeking a more just global order, we must understand this pervasive fear of loss of cultural identity that you saw in the manifestations of the little domes and the little minarets and so on, this pervasive fear of losing your cultural identity. So I have an agenda for the West, an agenda for the Muslims. For the West, as they tinker with the euro and try to fix the euro and so on, they should think about the meaning of Europe. Great imaginative people could see beyond the death and misery of the Second World War to the idea of really opening up a future united Europe. Today, young Germans and young Frenchmen like you can never imagine that their countries would go to war. And yet, their fathers could never imagine that Germany and France would one day be friends and allies. So all the identities are there. They're recognized. Germans remain Germans, French remain French, Italians remain Italians, but there is a European identity being forged. At the level of Switzerland, there is a Swiss case, which recently discussed the issue of minarets, but fundamentally, there's a lot of local identities. Languages are different, religions are different, the local cantons are different, but there is a Swiss identity on top of it. The German-speaking Swiss don't want to leave Switzerland to become part of Germany. The French-speaking Swiss don't want to leave Switzerland to become part of France. Switzerland has created that two-tier identity which we seek, and what we need to find is another way of doing it. In America, it used to be done by immigration. But pluralism and openness enriches cultures. And in fact, the entire modern movement in art, of which the West is so proud, was largely made because they opened up to other cultures. And here's a visual example of the transformation of 20th century art. Pablo Picasso, the greatest artist of that part of the century, he in fact did that closely influenced by a Guinean Nimba mask. That Gribo mask could become a guitar because he didn't care about anthropology. But the openness of the culture to other cultures resulted in bold new ways of doing it. Henri Matisse created this portrait of Madame Matisse influenced by a Shira Punta mask from what is today Burkina Faso. Emil Nolde of Germany did these masks influenced by Brazilian death masks. Max Ernst did this bird structure influenced by a mask from Central Africa, from Gabon. And Barnard Rossini did this Symphony No. 1 influenced by a Guinean religious mask. And the Demoiselle d'Avignon, one of the most famous paintings of all time, 1907 by Pablo Picasso, if you look at that, you will see how close it is to an Itumbi mask from Congo. So openness to other cultures enriches the artist of that culture to invent the new and do something else. The same way that he could draw on his own culture. This is Courbet's drawing, and that is Picasso's interpretation of it. So he drew on both. And then he produced things that really spoke to all the world and their culture, as when the Spanish Civil War occurred, the first bombing of a village occurred, and this is Guernica. And if you see that image, of course, it was captured by Serge Eisenstein in that image that you see there. So the great Guernica, for which the whole museum is available now, if you go to Spain, you'll see that one painting there, was again produced by it. So the artists in Europe, I tell them, these are your children, they're not out there, you have to deal with them as a minority, and don't be afraid of having minorities in your midst, because after all, Switzerland showed that, others showed that. Switzerland, in fact, is so respectful of minorities that they have a fourth language that nobody knows. You have the Swiss languages are German, French, Italian, and Romansh. Romansh is a fourth legal language in Switzerland. Only 50,000 people speak it in the whole world. They have four different textbooks for Romansh. So anyway, so what? The Muslim societies today have a lot of contradictions. And the developmental efforts are being stifled by inadequate integration, and the cultural dimension is needed. So let me give you visually, again, a few contradictions. I don't even need to say it. And they are right next to each other in the same swimming pool in Kandora, India. Look at these two. Here's one couple, and here's another couple. The same boat. Not different locations, same boat. And this guy, this is a Turkish milkman, very traditional milkman, but at the same time using a mobile phone. So modernity and tradition are really intermingled. So our complex societies have major discontinuities. And we need to revisit some of the hot topics. I've been working closely with the Mufti and the Sheikh Al-Azhar and others on these issues. And I say to all my Muslim friends, and I will go fast on this, although there are some here, you have to remember what your real tradition is about. Let there be no compulsion in religion. When addressed by the ignorant, say peace. That's what I keep citing to people who ask me, what about the film that just occurred about the Prophet? It's really how it should be done. Look at the great period of Islamic civilization, when from Andalusia to India, passing through Central Asia, these great civilizations were open and borrowed from each other, open to each other. They brought the zero from India, introduced the Indian numerals to the West, which became known as the Arabic numerals. The great Maimonides, Talmudic scholar, was Ibn Maimun in Andalusia, and so on and so forth. Ibn al-Haytham, he says, he who searches for truth follows argument and evidence, not statement by any other individual. On accepting the contrarian view, Ibn Nafis writes, when hearing something unusual, do not preemptively reject it, for that would be folly. In Arabic, the word is taish. Indeed, horrible things may be true, and familiar and brazen things may prove to be lies. Truth is truth unto itself, not because many people say it is. So there is this inherent tolerance of pluralism. There was this openness to the other. There was this willingness to simply, when somebody insults you, simply say, let them be. And this recognition of diversity is built into the Quranic interpretation, because we say, oh mankind, we created you of a male and a female and made you into nations and tribes that we may know each other. Ta'araf was the right word. And shu'uban wa qabail, and we expect that you will be different, you will recognize by the, and there is no ethnicity in it. There is la fadla ala rabbina ajami illa bittaqwa, and so on. So pluralism in views, connectivity, should not be confronted by intolerance. And it's not religious, it is general. If that intolerance is allowed to continue, it is no different than the intolerance of the young people who held up the Chairman Mao in an atheistic society. So it is not religious. In fact, in the Cultural Revolution in China, they said all we need are the thoughts of Chairman Mao, and they stopped things. Jefferson favored small town hall meetings and direct democracy where people vote. And in the Library of Alexandria, I hold meetings where people participate, discuss, and vote. Complex issues require careful study, not sweeping statements. And the practice of orderly debate is lacking in many of our societies, and we need to mobilize talent to deal with it, to uphold freedom of expression, for equality before the law, and that laws are crafted by humans. But now, given what's happening, I have to tell you a word about a very hot topic, which is the latest intolerance. Well, the latest. Because freedom of expression in the West and Muslim rage in the East are not new. The West sees it as free speech, and in the East it is considered blasphemy and hate speech. Now, where do you draw the line? Well, we know the story of the satanic verses with Salman Rushdie and the fatwa in 1989. I think it brought more attention to the book, the satanic verses, than it would have ever received otherwise, and certainly the same is true here. We had the cartoon controversy from the Danish cartoons shortly before we produced the report on the Alliance of Civilization. And now we have the film controversy that just came out a little while ago. Now to me, to explain to my friends in the West, I say you have to think of it in terms of accumulated fuels. And these fuels are the grievances, the victimization, the feeling of anger and alienation that exists. And then there's a small spark that comes and it lights a huge fire and an explosion. And people say, why such a small spark? Why such a big explosion? And I say, it's not the spark, it's the accumulated fuels. We have to remove these accumulated fuels of hatred and of victimization, because that's what makes it explode. If they weren't there, it would be just another spark that no impact. And I show people this, I remind them that the French riots that occurred in 2007 when Mr. Sarkozy was Minister of Interior at the time, that was not because of the cartoons, that was before the cartoons. And they had nothing to do with the cartoons. They exploded because of the accumulated anger of young Frenchmen inside France, Muslim, Arab descent, Frenchmen who were born and grew in France and who had this explosion. Similar to what happened in America with the blacks in 1965 when they burned Watts in Los Angeles and Washington and Detroit. This burnt pent-up anger exploded over there without resistance. So frequently, teaching pride in your own identity, which is good, can turn into indoctrination of intolerance of other identities, which is bad. I have to really watch out for how that teaching is being done. And I regret to say that this is so in some cases. Indoctrination starts early. Look at these young people here, then you shouldn't be surprised when you see them growing up into militias like that. Or look at these young girls here, you wouldn't be surprised when you see them very angry about disagreements on these issues. But the banning of books, again I say this to the West, is not just you. It's been happening to us inside our societies for a very long time. But censorship contravenes human rights and freedom of expression must be protected. And the battles must be fought again and again. In 1926, the great Taha Hussein, the greatest writer in the 20th century in Egypt, he didn't get the Nobel Prize, it was Nabil Mahfouz who got it, but nevertheless, he's considered the greatest writer. He was accused of apostasy and blasphemy. And 70 years later to the day, Nasr Hamid Abu Zayd was accused, another professor. 1926, the case was dismissed. In 1996, Nasr Hamid Abu Zayd was found guilty, and he was subjected to a lot of harassment, so he and his wife went to live in the Netherlands. I invited him to give a series of lectures. He passed away, actually, last year. But yes, Tahar Yunus, his wife, was there. But that's not enough. I'm just giving you an example that these battles exist within our own societies. They're not just battles between the West and the East. It's not a clash of civilizations. It is a transformation of values that is taking place, and is taking place within our societies. And my young friends prefer to go with summary statements. So their view is, let's not get complicated about this. Censorship sucks. Down with censorship. That's it. That's for young people. They are bloggers, they read each other's work, and I believe that we shall win. Obscurantist and extremist currents are standing against the tide of history and they shall lose. If you think of the Renaissance, people talk about Florence and the Medicis and Michelangelo. And who remembers today Savonarola? These are the Medicis. Well, he actually ruled Florence for 5 years. He was a very nasty, zealot priest who kicked the Medici men out. He forced the Medici women to burn all their clothes in public. It was called the Bonfire of the Vanities, which became a famous book afterwards. And he also confiscated their jewelry and melted it. And he went around burning at the stake people he disagreed with as heretics until he himself was killed. Today is just a blip in history, a footnote for scholars. But if you were living in Florence at the time of Savonarola, and Mr. Saragadin came and told you, don't worry about him, he is a mere blip in history, he will be a footnote, And you would say to me, but are you crazy? He's just murdered my cousin. He's about to burn my uncle, and my nephew is in jail because of him. I'd say, yes, but he's against the tide of history. So to remake our world, young people like you, have to dare to dream and to be bold. And I'm going to encourage you by giving you two examples, two very powerful examples. We can do things differently in our pursuit of equality and human rights, and working all together, we can do a lot for this generation and for the world. We can succeed. How? Two cases. One is the case of Antarctica, where in the 1950s they discovered minerals, oil, and other things, and people said, oh boy, we're going to take this and immediately bring in the bulldozers, start digging, look for oil, create not standards, lots of money, military bases, all the good stuff. And then a number of people, led by my good friend, the late Jack Cousteau and others, said, no, we should leave Antarctica with no industrialization, no utilization of resources, no military bases. It shall be left as wilderness and for science and for future generations. And they said to him, are you crazy? You want to leave a whole continent to a bunch of penguins? And he said, yes. And guess what? We got the agreement on Antarctica. And Antarctica, 50 years later, still has no military bases and no industrialization, only a few research stations. It's one of the victories that we had. In 1963, the civil rights movement in America, Martin Luther King stands and makes a famous speech, I Have a Dream, in which he said, I have a dream that my children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. It was realized, and I remember the 45 years between those two speeches. But in 45 years, they were not just judged by the content of their character. A black man was elected president, which at the time of Martin Luther King, when we had segregation, they couldn't enter through the same door. They had to stand in the back of the bus where they were couldn't drink from the same fountain as whites. Who would have thought that within less than half a century, the United States would actually elect a black president? Who said to us, remember the audacity of hope? A great lady, Margaret Mead, said, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. And she's right. But there are strong forces promoting hatred and anger in the West, as well as in the East. But we can defeat the forces of hate and confrontation. And if our group looks very small compared to the opposition, we are going to surprise the world. Thank you.
Societies that have lived next to each other for long periods of time not only get to know each other like neighbors, they also sometimes have wars with each other, they sometimes intermarry from each other, they sometimes get influenced by each other. So great writers in one language or one society are influenced by other great writers in the other society, and they change and modify. As I showed you the examples of how Picasso and Braque and Matisse changed Western art by being open to art from totally different cultures. So it happens much more when they are next to each other. Manifestations of culture include everything from the way we dress, to the way we speak, to the way we eat, what food we like, what music we compose and play. And
in that, I think there are common elements. But it's more of a variety of the kind of when we say there is a common culture of Europe. Yes. But the culture of Europe is also when you talk about what happens in Germany, what happens in France, what happens in Scandinavia, what happens in, I use Scandinavia right now, but Scandinavia is part of the Nordic group, and within Scandinavia you have Denmark, Sweden, and Norway, each of which have their own language and their own literature as well. So it's that pluralism that is not only embedded within Asia Minor, but also should be largely tolerated as a source of richness, not as a source of danger. That is the message that we must take.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Maybe the center will be founded in future for such kind of investigations and research.
Indeed, indeed, we do have one. Dr. Azar, please stand up. This is Dr. Azar Khouri, a professor at the University of Alexandria, and who is at the Library of Alexandria helping me in the creation of the Center for Democracy and Social Peace. Social peace is about exactly what you're asking about, Mr. Lecter, and I'm sure that you'll be very happy to work with whoever you designate at this university.
So we will cooperate with
you. Indeed, indeed. Yeah, I look forward to that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Any questions? Please.
In the French culture, you have mentioned the culture of course.
Sorry, the culture?
The culture of Corsi.
Ah, yeah, well, I said that. Even then, there are nuances within, and I mentioned, well, the patron and others, there are various sub, if you want.
Maybe not
sub,
but subculture, but maybe the other roots, the culture of Corsi.
Yes.
So-called old Mediterranean culture.
Yes.
You know that they have polyphony, as in Georgia. And to let old
Mediterranean
yes. goes back the forest you have mentioned.
Yes.
It had roots in old times. This one. And the second. The etymology of Africa. In civilization, you can be, if I'm not mistaken, the Arctic of Emil Benvenist. He supposed that it is Latin origin.
That's one.
But I want, what's your opinion about the etymology of Africa?
Well, that's a different question. Etymology of words and roots. That is, we have, of course, geographic designations of Africa that date back to antiquity. I mean, after all, Scipio Africanus was well known in the Roman Empire by his conquest in Africa. We have cultures of the African shore that claim their own identities, whether it is Carthage or it is Phoenicians or it is others. That interacted with Rome and interacted even before that with Greece and with the Persian Empire, before Rome became a center. And in these cultures, most of them refer to Africa. So I can't tell you the exact origin that I would adhere to, but I know that it's quite old as a geographic designation. But within that, there were many other cultures, because Alexandria, founded by Alexander, 31 BC became the center of the Hellenistic world. And but yeah, but there is a designation of that. Kaurima or Cyrenaica in Libya was a major source of the five communities that they were known, Greek communities in North Africa today. So I wouldn't be able to tell you where they, at least for me, I don't know enough to be able to say the origin of Africa, but I know that it's very old. It's a designation, as I said, you know, if you think of Scipio Africanus. And then today it has been so denigrated in the efforts of global, since the colonial period I can show another lecture, dealing with how the West divided Africa without any consideration for either the local people, their cultures, their languages, etc., just grabbing the different pieces of the coast and then moving in, you know, the Spanish and the French and the British and the Germans and the treaty, and consolidated the Treaty of 1885. But today, I work so much in Africa with all these different cultures, this richness, this vibrancy, this enormous power in terms of cultural expression that has influenced. I showed the example on painting, but I could do much more with music. Music has had an enormous influence. Brazil, the Afro-Brazilian community, which is the second largest black community in the world, in one country after Nigeria, in terms of aggregate size. And in America, jazz music, which permeates the roots up to rock and roll and other modern things, all of these would come from African cultures. But somehow, Africa has been misunderstood. So I just simply pointing out just how big and how vast and how different and how rich Africa is and how little we know about it. So I think we should know a lot more. And I think France has done a lot to know more about cultures, but there's more to be done by all of us.
Well, any other question? As for the etymology, the Asia and Europe, these two words, they are not Indo-European words. They are, they have etymology for 70 languages. Yes.
From Semitic languages?
Yes, please.
You said that censorship is bad, but do I have a right to astonish and laugh at other groups' values and culture and all the horrible things? And do we still call a censorship if we protect their rights and their values from me?
I'm sorry, I didn't quite understand the question. You said censorship is generally bad, but if should we protect against hate speech? Yes, the answer is usually we say yes, but then the difficulty comes in our inability to define where the boundaries of hate speech and the boundaries of criticism begin. That's where it becomes difficult. So when you start saying, yes, we should not encourage people to promote hatred of other people, it's difficult because laws that exist today simply talk of individual rights. So if you accuse me of being a thief and you have no evidence that I'm a thief, then I can take you to court and I will usually win a defamation suit, libel, or slander, depending on the case. And on the other hand, if you criticize and say, I think what is happening in the banking sector collapse has been nothing short of theft, theft of the savings of the poor people, theft of the taxes of the people who paid to bail out these banks and so on, that is criticism. Now, what about if you start saying, all these bankers are thieves? Well, that's beginning to go somewhere different. But what if you say all Jewish bankers are thieves, or all Jews are thieves, or all Muslims are thieves? Now, this is really going into hate speech because you are attacking entire groups and generalizing against away from specific events. And in most countries, there are some regulations on that. But the difficulty in practicing it has resulted, in at least in American constitutional law, in saying that at the end of the day, only free speech and more free speech will be protected, and only if you as an individual have been attacked in free speech, then you can sue. And generalities are defended. At least there are many examples of successful stories of that, including famous Jewish lawyers. I was just talking about that earlier, Arya Meyer and David Goldberger, who defended the Nazis, not the American Nazi Party, against a predominantly Jewish neighborhood of Chicago called Skokie. And the said, they have the right, and many Jewish people sent attacks to them. They said, you are traitors, how can you possibly defend the Nazis? And they said, we are not defending the Nazis. We are defending the right of free speech and the constitutional right in America for every citizen to say what they want to say and to express themselves politically. And as long as this is allowed, and they follow the rules of asking for a permit, they should be allowed to demonstrate. Because tomorrow, and these were Jewish lawyers defending against a Jewish community, and they said, we should learn the lesson of Hitler. When Hitler rose to power, he started tackling one group, and then another, and then another, including the Jews, the Gypsies, the Catholics, the Slavs, and so on. And in the end, it was pure Nazi or nothing. But if from the beginning people had said, no, we have to defend the rights of citizenship, that is right. How you will draw that boundary is where culture comes in. What is acceptable is changing from time to time. For example, you or I or anybody cannot run naked in the street. It is not acceptable. In almost every society, it will be banned. And that ban is a limit on freedom of my freedoms. But nevertheless, it's a ban that is societally acceptable. At an earlier age, and different countries may have different views, women in bathing suits were not seen in Western beaches until the 20th century. The two-piece bathing suit came in the second half of the 20th century. The bikinis came later. But societies have different values at different times. And I think this is where we have to go back to saying societies have to craft together what they do and to think about how they're going to cope with the promotion of pluralism and acceptance of the other. Every society has to grapple with that issue, whether in the West or in the East.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This lecture is a distinguished lecture of Professor Sirajeldin. Is dedicated to the memory of Chotar Shtareli's United Independence scheme and the memory of Nizami Kanjavi, which is celebrated tomorrow in Kanja, in Azerbaijan. So we are very much pleased and very much proud that by the UNESCO, the night the Independence King of Rustaveli is announced this year, Rustaveli's year. So your visit is related with this event, and thank you very much. And I the gratitude by the name of the whole university and professors and students.
Well, thank you, Mr. Rector. And I'd like to tell you that we have just agreed with the Minister of Culture to promote Arabic translation of Rustaveli's United Independence. So that's that will be a joint project between your country and mine.
Yes. It will be second translation. The first translation was in 2003. In 1983.
Well, that's where we'll start with.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay.